And this week we are talking max performance versus max consistency. And this is something that doesn't have a whole lot of sexiness to it, but it's something that I think is happening in the golf industry, and not a lot of golfers hear about it because it's not a real marketable term right now. But anyway, we're adding a new component to our wedge test, and that will be released in a couple weeks, that will show some level of who is doing a more consistent job on pretty much every shot, that or more shots that you're going to encounter on the golf course, right?
Yep.
So that got us talking about max consistency, and what that means is, you know, back when they changed the wedge groove rule, all the wedge companies came out and were talking about how they wanted to get everybody back to that number. But really what people should be paying more attention to across the board, not just wedges, drivers, everything, is consistency more than maximum performance. So I'll give you a couple examples. Ping and Mizuno seem to be doing a really good job, not at marketing this, but at including this in their golf club design in regards to consistency. So for example, with Ping, their new wedge grooves, wet, dry, perform fairly similarly. And in early testing, we're already seeing that a lot of wedges, huge drop off when there's a little bit of moisture involved in the shot. Let's take drivers, for example. I remember back to the TaylorMade Aero Burner. You remember that, Tony, where damn was that thing long, but man, you missed it by just a small amount. And, you know, everybody talks forgiveness or accuracy kind of left to right, right? I'm more interested, or just as interested, is the forgiveness front to back. So yes, it will go 285 yards, but if you miss hit it and it goes 240, that 40 yard circle is not what you're looking for. So when you hit a ping driver, generally what you see is 280, but right. Then when you miss hit it, 272,
right.
That circle's a lot tighter, right? So consistency of ball speed, consistency of distance, consistency of spin numbers, consistency of launch angle, all those things aren't sexy in a launch monitor battle when you're there getting fit. But when you hit thousands of shots, they play out really importantly downrange and start becoming real performance, right? So let's talk about that. Chris, you know, we discussed it obviously before the show started, but what are your thoughts on that, you know, and what do you think?
Yeah, I think it's a paradigm shift. And so I think the bigger point is, how do we get consumers to start understanding that is really that important? It makes me go back and think at Tony's course, a couple of the par threes are really easy par threes. As long as you hit the green. And, you know, we've seen that now with Titleist new T series, you know, replacing the AP series. They're talking about distance, dispersion, descent angle as part of the fitting metrics, right? And then we've seen that also with Mizuno in their T20 series wedges, how they want the spin to be commensurate regardless of if you're coming out of the rough. Is it wet? Is it dry? Is it a buried lie, et cetera? And like you said, the hard part about it, that's not very sexy. It doesn't, you know, you put that on a banner and people go, oh,
sexy,
the most consistent irons in golf.
Well, think about it, right? You know? When a guy goes to get fit for a driver or a set of irons, what one metric does he give a shit about?
Distance.
That's it. And not just like, how far did these two irons go? It's how far did one shot go, and whichever one won by one shot. Like,
right.
I'll never forget, I was at PSG and we were getting fit and I was hitting a 7-iron 217 yards, right? And guy walks by and says, hey, bend that 1 degree stronger. I don't need any more distance out of 217. I just want 217 every
over
shot.
Over and over,
right?
And over. Yeah.
And that is the difference, I think. Tony and I talk about it all the time. It's the people that are winning are the companies that are evolutionary, not revolutionary. Tech isn't going to be happening very often anymore. It's just not. No. Because of the limits that are set, right? So then it becomes, all right, everybody's pushed this limit. Who can be at that limit every shot and consistently near that limit, right? Mm-hmm. And those are the companies that are winning, in my opinion. It's kind of like I always analogize the 50-meter, you know, swimming event with what's his name? And I've said it before.
Michael Phelps.
He always wins by like a microsecond, right? But how is it that that guy always wins by a microsecond?
Yeah, and that, I mean, to that point, it makes me think of, you know, a couple of good examples, like Ping with the LST, the 410. They didn't have that driver ready to come out at the same time as the rest of the series because, frankly, it was really hard to beat the 400 LST. It was a fantastic driver.
They admitted that in the boardroom when we were talking about it.
And they were very open about it, right? Like, we legitimately couldn't make something better. And so when you finally saw that come out in, what was it, June, July, the biggest change was a couple additional fitting metrics to allow the club to be fit a little bit flatter. Mm-hmm. That's not revolutionary. It's evolutionary. And it's that little difference that might allow somebody to get that front back dispersion or the left right dispersion dialed in a little bit Sam more, which is huge.
Sam was fitting me for that 410 LST one day, and he just cranked down the flat lie fitting that was new on the driver, and immediately, boom. You know, so it's making that driver whatever percentage better, right? 1% better,
right?
2-5% better. It's the stuff that they're. I love Ping for this, and this isn't a sponsored, you know, no putts given, so I don't want to hear this from anybody, but I love Ping.
You will.
I love Ping, man, because they're not looking to market something fancy. They're doing things behind the scenes that are just no one would think of, and even if it makes them 1% better, the product, they're going to do that, you know, and it's not even marketed. Some of these things are never even told to consumers.
Right, like you don't have the shirt like, hey, we have flatter lies.
No. Or we stick our stickers under our putter grips so you don't, you're not distracted when you look down them. So,
right.
You know, Tony, what do you think? Like, which companies do you see that are doing a good job about evolutionarily designing product to be more consistent rather than maximizing just one shot?
Well, I think maybe we don't have the full picture necessarily of who's doing all of the little things, right? Because these little things aren't particularly sexy. So if you're one of the bigger companies, right? Callaway's probably the best example right now. Like, the little thing isn't even worth talking about because, you know, flash face, right? Like, that's like, we've got this new revolutionary face design that's going to change everything in everything moving forward forever, right? It's that kind of, that's kind of where the bigger companies are. And not that Ping is a small company, but you know, they're, if you took a look at market share and things like that, they're definitely not Callaway, but it is. So, and again, I think Ping, you're probably right, is a great example. You know, it's just little, tiny little things that are easy to gloss over in a press release, for example. So, you know, hey, we put the sticker under on the underside of the putter shaft or moved it up the putter shaft so your eyes don't shift to that while you're standing over the ball, because we found that really weird thing while we were using, you know, our special goggles in testing. Or, you know, the one that I've been thinking about quite a bit lately is the hydro pearl finish that they're using on their irons and wedges, right? Increased hydrophobicity, meaning that it repels the water. The water doesn't bead, it runs off. And, you know, you're sort of, okay, cool story, bro, right?
But that's not even something that consumers think about when they go to play. Like, if you poll 10 golfers, how many of them actually know that their ball performs differently when it's 8 o'clock in the morning and there's still dew on the ground versus 3 o'clock in the afternoon?
One. If I had to guess, it'd be 25%.
That's what I'm saying. 1 to 2.
Personally, after the ball test, we saw with the wet wedge test how much it changed. And now anytime I go out on a Saturday morning, I'm so cognizant. I make sure that my wedge face is dry, and I'm making sure that I'm trying to control variables.
Perfect example that leads me into, you know, what we're doing right now, which is wet versus dry wedge testing, right? We're not going to give the names out yet until we're done testing. But in early testing, there are wedges that, let's say wet versus dry, that perform very similarly to each other. And there are wedges that when you add even the slightest bit of water to the scenario, the performance dramatically changes and plummets, you know? And that's from
it's some of those numbers are like, did the water fill in the grooves completely? Like, what happened here?
Yeah, so it's insane. Yeah, so, and last time I checked, golf has played in a lot of different conditions.
Right.
So this gets back to the story of maximizing consistency versus maximizing what looks cool, bro. And that's this thing go really far, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, Sam is in the test facility every day seeing this and sees the products that are consistent standard deviation, which, you know, is a fancy word for nobody gives a shit except us probably. But those things really matter, you know? And it's the small things that no one's going to know about or no one's going to really care about. But I think eventually, there's going to be a shift that changes towards that, because that is what we are starting to see more on a yearly basis of the improvements we see from the companies providing new product for testing. They're not getting longer. They're getting more consistent, the good ones. And the ones that are winning our testing aren't the ones that are flash in the pan marketing stuff. It is quietly just deadly assassins on consistency. And after 10,000 shots, like I said, downrange, that's starting to show up as winning, you know?
Yeah, and I think
A fantastic example, right? Because we've talked to quite a bit about ping, but if you look at our driver test is kind of a different way to look at it, right? So Callaway Epic Flash Sub-Zero won that test, right? Mm-hmm. And if we go back and we look at the data, it's not because it was significantly longer than anything else, right? It, you know, by the numbers, I think it was one of the longest, but certainly it wasn't like, you know, holy shit, this thing just obliterated the field. It won because guys hit it consistently straight. Like, you know, the correlation we found with strokes gained in that particular test was with fairway percentage, right? And again, the kind of the ripple there, we think of strokes gained as, well, you know, the farther you can get it down the fairway or up the golf course, that then the better it is. And that's true when you're comparing Dustin Johnson to Zach Johnson, but at an individual level where my capacity to create different distance differences between drivers is maybe an average of 5 yards if I'm reasonably well fit for everything, maybe 5 yards, not even. It really comes down to which one I hit straight and consistently straight most often. And that's a tough sell. So what I find myself wondering is, you know, in a lot of cases, would golfers be, you know, I guess not would they, it's how much better served would a golfer be if he lost, you know, what's the cutoff point? If I could lose X yards off the tee, but cut my standard deviations for key metrics in half, how much better off would that be on the scorecard?
Yeah, I mean, case in point, massive. That's why I play cavity back irons and not blades, because they're more, I'm not going to hit the center of the club face all the time. I'm a +2 handicap, but I know that my ball speed consistently is higher.
Yeah. Well, no, I think, and to your point, Tony, I think one of the questions we have to answer then is, or at least think about, is take the Callaway, for example. People see that, you know, that club won our driver test, and I would imagine correlate the flash face technology with some of those results. But as you said, that really wasn't the reason it won. It won because of the consistency that it offered, not necessarily what the first marketing pitch is from Callaway.
And
so,
you were talking about that earlier when readers come to my golf spy and look at the driver test, you were like, they come down and go, well, this is the longest, and, you know, don't pay attention to that as much, because it really is, it's hard. We're in a difficult place right now where we collect all this data, and what we show you isn't the truth of why things win, but we know we have to show you all this data, but right. We have these protocols and kind of, you know, testing algorithms, however you want to put it, on what we've defined as being a better club performance, performing club for every golfer. And we have a theory on why that is,
right?
Which doesn't directly correlate to, hey man, this is the longest club, right? There's right. All these other factors, and consistency, you know, is one of them for sure. So just a reminder, last time I checked, all golfers miss hit, right? So all golfers need more consistent products, not just ones that perform when you dead nut one right on the screws, you know?
Yeah.
Well, dead nut one, and I guess from a fitting perspective, right? Like, and not always in dry conditions. And, you know, we can poke holes in some of what we do, and we can poke holes in fitting paradigms and things like that. But, I mean, there are certain realities here. So I'd be curious if anybody listening to this in their fitting, whether it be for an iron or a wedge, for example, has ever, you know, hit their series of shots and gone, all right, that was awesome. Now can we go, you know, see how this performs when it gets a little bit of moisture on it, right? Because that's just typically not something we do. And yet, you know, that's the kind of thing we're starting to see, right? The ping finish story has been around for a couple of years. Mizuno now with its new grooves to channel water. I would desperately hope, based on what we saw in the ball test, that somebody is working on a cover material for a golf ball that can maintain softness, maintain spin, and channel more water off of the ball. Because all of these things are tremendously important when you get out on the golf course, especially in the morning, like Sam mentions. And it's just it's never a consideration, and that may be because we sort of assume that, hey, everything is equal, but that's not the case.
Well, let's put some hard numbers on this real quick, right? So the average golfer out there or golfers listening can start to understand some of the ramifications of this. The two factors, Sam, spin and launch angle, right? Give me a percentage change, dry versus wet, that you've seen so far, from so, good to bad.
Yeah, so in fooling around with some testing protocols, testing a bunch of different wedges, both wet and dry, personally, I saw in some wedges 5 and 6 degrees, I think it was.
Increased launch.
Increased launch angle, and then, gosh, I want to say it was in the 2000s, 2 or 3 thousands, yeah, for dry.
It was somewhere around
50%.
We have to go back and crunch it. It was 65 to 75% reduction in spin, I think, yeah, on the terrible end of that. I
mean, all right, so think about that.
And that was in Sam's super limited. Hey, let's just try a few and see if this is worth doing a bigger test on. And
so wet ball.
We looked at that number and went, holy shit, yeah, we need to really look at this.
So dry ball. 60-yard shot, okay?
7,500.
Higher spin, lower launch, mm-hmm, right? Ball gets wet for not all wedges, but for some wedges, 65% reduction in spin and about a 25 to 30% increase in launch angle.
Well, think about it like this. If I'm hitting a wedge from 60 yards into a green and I'm getting 7,500, 8,000 RPMs of spin, and then we reduce that by 65%, we're coming in with driver spin.
Yeah, like 3,200.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, high driver spin. So three would spin.
Which means you're not going to hold the green.
It ain't going to go anywhere near the hole. I can tell you that. Yeah. So.
Well, I just don't think the average person understands that. So that's what we're kind of talking about today in Shot of the Truth. I just hope, like Tony said, how many golfers out there have gone into a fitting and one looked at anything other than distance? Start doing that. Start looking at, you know, holding your fitter accountable to some other numbers, at least maybe one more. And Tony, if you had one thing to tell golfers out there that are going to get fit that would not just look at distance, what would the other most important factor be?
So the thing I say all the time, right, is you want to look for small numbers and small circles. And what that means is every launch monitor, or the ones that I'm aware of anyway, that a real fitter would use, will show you the standard deviation of key metrics. So not only how far is it going, but an idea of how consistently is it going far, which I think is more important, or, you know, delivery of the club, just whatever is important, look at that standard deviation. And then again, every launch monitor will give you an elliptical downrange pattern that kind of shows your shot cluster. And the smaller that cluster gets, the more consistent, at least the expectation, right? Doesn't always translate, but hopefully, you know, good fitter, it's going to translate to the courses as a more consistent dispersion pattern.
And just give golfers an idea. So take drivers and irons. How many shots should a guy that's going to get fit for a driver, let's say doing a head-to-head, hit for each driver to get a good enough baseline?
Oh, you know, everybody we've worked with has always told us 10 to 12 good shots. Now, that's a fitting scenario is a little bit different in that a good fitter is going to be able to throw something out pretty quickly. So most fitters will start with 4 or 5. But, you know, what I like to do when I fit guys is sort of toss what's not working and sort of just pare it down. And then when you get to a couple things that you know are in the ballpark, that's where you really start to spend some time and try and get a larger sample size. But the ripple there, too, is in a fitting scenario. If you're starting from a broad, wide space and you've got a narrow and narrow and narrow, you can get to the point where fatigue gets to be an issue pretty quickly.
No, so, I'm saying like once they've narrowed it down to a head-to-head scenario, 10 to 12 shots, correct?
Yeah, that's what I mean. That again, that's what I like to use. That's what the guys in Carlsbad and Phoenix and everywhere else we've talked to say that, you know, that's what they want to see from an R&D testing perspective. And again, like if that's the number that the industry relies on, I think it makes sense in a fitting scenario, with the caveat being like, yeah, as you get deeper into it, fatigue becomes an issue and it may not always be possible. But yeah, that's what I like.
Yeah, and sometimes fitters will go in, like I've been to a driver fitting before, and I remember we were hitting a bunch of different shafts and we narrowed down the head that I wanted, and then we started working through shafts, and if I hit one, I mean remotely, if he was like, if you don't catch it dead nuts, I'm gonna delete it. But at the end of the day, I want to see those numbers that aren't dead nuts, because I know that there's going to be a time I'm going to hit a driver that isn't.
That's what we always say. We want to, in our testing, right, we have an outlier detection system that is what its job is to do is to take away the golfer's ability and make it about the club, right? But you have to keep the miss, some of the miss hits, you know, terrible miss hits are your fault, right?
Right.
But you want to know which ones are not your fault that the club had influence on, right? So if you miss it just a little bit, if he throws that, we know definitively that some clubs perform better on, you know, a full face rather than just dead center shots, right? So you want to know that because golfers miss it.
Yeah, when golfers from our test group come in and say, hey, you know, what three wood did I test best with? It's not, I don't just go to the stat sig sheet and say, okay, this is your best one. I look at the launch metrics, I look at their ball speed, I look at their standard devs of ball speed, carry consistency, things like that, that matter because, I mean, let's be real, like I said, you're not going to hit every golf
charge, do you charge for fittings?
Testers get complimentary information.
I think that's a good side business for you.
What?
I mean, seriously, like the fittings that I see you guys do in there compared to the fittings I see in the real world.
Well, the reality is, like, I mean, how many times have you gone to a fitting and the guy's like, all right, well, this is your best drive on this driver, so we're gonna look at those numbers.
Put it this way, I've never been to a good fitting.
Well, and again, it's all about where you go and the experience and the expertise.
No, but name
and to a degree, the philosophy of the fitter, right? If you know, the example I keep going back to is probably the best fitting experience I've ever had is when I did my TS driver fitting at Titleist with Glenn. Like his approach is very similar to what we end up with our outlier detection system. Like he's not dropping a lot of shots. Like,
yeah, but you don't get those fitting opportunities at your local Dick's.
60 yards right. Like, it stays in the set because when you're on the golf course, you don't get to drop that shot, right? Like,
you have
to see how a club performs when you miss it because the reality is you're going to miss it. A lot of us are going to miss it just as much as we hit it dead nut center. And if you want to talk about little misses, way more often. So this idea of, like, from a fitting perspective, you know, any fitter who says, "Yeah, I'm really only going to look at your really good shots," man, that's leave. Just
yeah.
Leave.
Unfortunately, Tony, not all the readers out there, listeners out there, have access to Glenn at TPI.
Yes, Tony forgets that sometimes. You know what I mean?
Well, no, but certainly Glenn is not the only good fitter.
You know, Glenn by a first name that works at Titleist. I mean, not many people have that ability. Like most people are going to Dick's or PJ Superstore.
That's where you go to. You know, that's where like the expertise of a cool clubs or a club champion.
Yeah. Let me put it to you like this, Tony. You remember who this guy was? We were at the PGA show, and this company, which was the biggest company in golf at the time for drivers, had their number one fitter at the PGA show, fitting people. Bingo. There you go. Enough said. And that's what I'm talking about. I've never been a part of a good fitting.
In fairness, right, that's not a true fitting. Let's see if we can impress these guys with a big number.
But here's the difference. That's generally what you do for PGA people coming to the show. But they knew we were a part of the media and they knew we worked for mygolfspy. So shouldn't you want to like make sure you do the proper fitting?
Again, it's like let's try and impress the guy we're fitting and anybody who happens to be watching with a big number.
That's every fitting I've ever had.
That's a shame. I mean that sucks because there are some really good fitters who approach it as, you know, I can find you a club that you're going to hit the longest ball with, but that's not going to serve you well on a golf course.
Right. How can people get in touch with Glenn?
At Titleist.
At Titleist.
Not just Glenn.
Easier said than done, I think.